It was very close to his heart. And so within the Divine Mercy, also with John Paul II, John Paul II gave us a whole, what we call theology of the body. I'm not going to go so much into theology of the body today. I'm just going to touch on a couple of the principles. If you're wondering where I'm drawing some of this from, a lot of it will be from theology of the body, but actually where John Paul II was drawing from was from Scripture. That's where some people think, well, John Paul, the theology of the body is kind of just like John Paul's personal opinions or thoughts on male and female. No, he was drawing very much from the Jewish tradition as well as from the Scriptures very heavily. Because when you understand the Scriptures, especially the way in which male and female are presented in the Scriptures as well as within theology, you have an understanding of what it means for the two of them to become one. And also what the design for Christian understanding of marriage is. So femininity, one of the questions which I think is posed to many people in the world today, is what is present? Is there something present in femininity which is not present in masculinity? Okay. Or another way, what satisfies the feminine heart? Again, I think there was a movie with that Mel Gibson tried making, What Women Want, right? But what is it in femininity? Is femininity just an organic reality? Is being female just organic, bodily? And that actually, if you change your body, you can therefore change your gender. So often, I think everyone in this room probably is familiar with the notion that's going on in the world today, is what's referred to as gender fluidity. Is gender kind of just fluid thing which kind of goes, or is it something which is more? Because if you connect gender to just being a bodily reality, then you could possibly say that gender can be changed. But then the question is gender just a bodily reality? Now, interesting, you can't change your genetic code. Even people who go through gender changes and try to change their gender, they don't change their DNA. Their DNA still is going to be what it was when they were born. But regardless, the question really becomes is there something more to our gender than just body chemistry? Because also, what satisfies the feminine heart? And then the other question is there something present in masculinity that is not present in femininity? Obviously, on an organic level, you can see very clearly the differences. But then the question becomes, is there something on an emotional level? And is there possibly even something on a spiritual level which is different between the two genders? Now, this is something which the Church does not have an official teaching on in terms of actually answering these others, but drawing upon these questions. Now, many people, if you just equate gender to your organic body structure, then obviously then this solves the question. But from our perspective, actually, in people like Joseph Pieper, I believe it is, several different theologians in the world today are talking a lot about this because this is one of the main things that our culture is facing. Is this idea of let's reinterpret, let's redefine, and let's gender be whatever we want it to be. Whatever my personal preference is I can therefore define it. And therefore I can be what I want to be. But there is no limitations upon us. But see, in genders, and also in the scriptural understanding of gender, is that there are definitive roles which are played by a male. There are definitive roles which are played by a female. Although this is not always understood the way that we oftentimes in our culture understand what we refer to as gender roles. But in Scripture, there is most certainly gender roles, because one of the gender roles which you see in the New Testament is the role of Jesus Christ as the bridegroom. And very specifically, the language which St. Paul refers to the church as is as not as just an amorphous blob or just a conglomeration of people. He calls the church, anyone know? The bride. Yeah. He uses gendered roles to describe the relationship between God, the Christ, the God-man, Christ, and humanity. Bride, bridegroom. And so within this, also drawing upon the ancient understanding from Genesis and going through the entirety of the Old Testament, when the people of Israel as a collective whole are referred to by God, it is always in the feminine. It's always the people of the people collectively. Now, some people would say, well, this is just a cultural thing. That's how people refer to things at the time. No, actually, if you go to the book of Hosea very specifically, the people of Israel are always referred to as actually a prostitute bride, a bride who has prostituted themselves. You'll find this in Ezekiel. I don't know if anyone has read, anyone here read the whole book of Ezekiel? In Ezekiel, you'll actually have this one point where Ezekiel will have to go out and wear a loincloth. Because this is what you are, you're a dirty loincloth, which is around the loins and things like this. We're referring to the people, that they are what, the unfaithful bride. This notion of unfaithful bride is one of the most commonly used comparisons of how the people of Israel collectively are always referred to. You'll also find this relationship between male and female, especially found in the patriarchs. You find it with Isaac and Rebekah at the well. You'll find it with Jacob and Rachel at the well. And you'll see that Jesus will actually parallel these male and female roles in the New Testament, such as with the Samaritan woman who he finds at a well, which is all cultural, but also goes into this question of gender. Because within gender, we have an understanding in our church, as well as what we would say is reality, is your identity is gender specific. Because your gender is either, we don't say male or female, we would say masculine or feminine. And the reason is that just because something is male does not make it masculine. You wouldn't call a dog masculine. Human beings are masculine. Men are masculine. But well, just because they're male, again, just being an animal doesn't equate to masculinity. Because we are spirit, we have our organic structure as well as our sexuality, things like this, is increased. We actually, why? Because we know it. We can understand it. We can also experience it. This is, makes actually our needs deeper than an animal's. Many people who just want to equate sexuality to animal need don't take into account, one, our psychology and just our basic mind structure is going to actually deepen our awareness, which will deepen our needs. Does this make sense? Because of this, you can't just equate sexuality to animal nature. Because many of the things, some people will say, well, sexuality and things like this, use that, you've seen it in nature, therefore it's okay, because we see animals doing it over here. Actually, you'll see that actually, even in nature, animals don't do what human beings would do. But actually, even so, you'll also find that, for instance, one of the things which causes tremendous psychological damage to a person is when they experience unfaithfulness, cheating, correct? I don't think anyone would deny that. But what? Animals don't experience that. They don't experience trauma of when something that they mated with goes out and just mates with something else. But we don't see that for the most part. There's a few certain species, wolves, elephants, things like this, that mate for life. But for the most part, animals don't mate for life. And they also don't experience the psychological trauma. Because what? They don't have the psyche. Right? Therefore, so because we have intellect, right? And also because we have free will, which is actually what Thomas Aquinas will call the two principles of the spirit. There might be more to spiritual reality than that. But these are two things that we can quantifiably say are principles of spiritual reality. It's also why he defines angels as beings of pure will and pure intellect. But because we have intellect and because we have will, it's going to make our experience of our bodies, as well as our experience of all the irrational parts of our soul, all of the things which make us like animals, because we still are animals, but it will increase and intensify the experiences of these things. Now you might think this is okay, this is really redundant, I already know these things. These principles are really, really important. Because if you lay these principles out, you'll see very quickly why the church believes what it believes in terms of gender as well as in terms of marriage. Because our identity is male, is either masculine or feminine. And because of this, our identity leads us to a role. And the role which we have is either as a husband, father, or as a mother and a wife, right? See, only a feminine woman can be a mother or and a wife. And only a masculine man can be a husband or a father, okay? These are what we refer to as our gender roles, right? Then you get below that to responsibilities, okay? We really have no, the gender responsibilities are non-gendered, they're tasks. So these are oftentimes what's going to be culturally assigned, right? So what you do in your culture, what men do in a culture, what women do in a culture, for the most part, the tasks, the responsibilities, who cuts the grass, who washes the dishes, these things are not by nature part of our gender, all right? These are the roles which culture assigns and things like that. And that's where some people will say, when they confuse or they combine the two, when they combine the responsibilities with the roles, you can very seriously get into problems. But if you see a separation between that, because what? Either person can cut the grass. Either person can wash the dishes. Either person can take the kids. Either person can be the primary breadwinner. Things of this nature. But only one of them can nurse. Okay. Only one of them can nurse. Only one of them can inseminate. Right? There are certain things that only a male can do. Only one of them can be a father. Now, you can have two dads, or you can have two moms. But what? If you have two dads or two moms, you still will not have a mother, or you won't have a father. Period. So it's not, because some people are like, but you still have two. We're not talking about quantity. We're talking about quality, because there is a qualitative difference between the sexes. Both of them contribute something uniquely that the other one does not. And actually, I can show this from Scripture. I can show this actually from Scripture, that there is a qualifiable difference between men and women. How can I do that? But still, I also say this, what are each of them seeking? What brings fulfillment to the two genders? Because what satisfies one will not satisfy the other. And what satisfies the other will not satisfy the one. Is that both of them have a different starting point. They both have the same ending point, which is God. But their starting point is different. And it's more than just on the level of biology. Because if they were both exactly the same, then sin would actually affect them exactly the same. If there was no difference, if the only difference was on an organic bodily level, then sin would actually affect Adam and Eve exactly the same. But if you go into the Scriptures, sin does not affect them exactly the same. Why do I get to this? Because what is common? What is the parts which are unique to femininity? What are the parts which are unique to masculinity? And what is that one between the two? What satisfies the masculine heart, the feminine? Well, we know this about relationship. Relationships are built upon what we have in common and also what we don't have in common. Actually, this is what we refer to as common friendships, uncommon arrows, right? Things that we have in common with one another. Those are things that actually will strengthen the bond. Actually, what has come out recently was a great book by a guy by the name of secular psychologist by the name of John Gottman. And it's called The Seven Principles That Make a Marriage Work. And one of the main things that actually came out in his book is that marriages that last and marriages that work are built upon friendship. Not eros, but are primarily built upon friendship. That when there is a strong friendship between the two sexes, now some people don't think that actually friendship is possible between the two sexes. Some people think that no, you can never have a friendship. No, you can have a friendship between the two sexes. Actually, if you have a friendship as the foundation of a marriage, the marriage will last. That's why Gottman will actually say that he can, within 5 minutes, he can tell with a 97% probability whether or not the couple's going to break up. Because he can evaluate very quickly if they have a friendship or not. And if they don't have a friendship, if their entire relationship is based upon either their kids and their family, thus storge, affection, or if it's just based upon eros, it's not going to last. Is that only relationships which are based primarily and deeply upon friendship are the ones that last. But it's not just friendship, because there's something within marriage which goes beyond friendship, which is the erotic, which is eros, which is those things that we do not have in common. Which is why couples who have nothing in common together, and the only thing they have in common is their kids or things like that, they're going to have problems. They need to have what? Those common activities, those common things. It's the things that brought them together in the first place. But sometimes those things go by the wayside, and therefore you have a problem in the friendship. It's actually important when dealing with a relationship in a marriage, is, and that's one of the things which I try to identify usually first when couples come to me for marital counseling, things like that, is what type of problem do we have here? Are you having a problem with eros? And they might think it's eros, but actually it's more often than not what the problem is with their friendship. Or is it a problem with the kids, and therefore that's affecting the friendship, things like that? But when you can sometimes not totally separate, some of these things are totally separate, but when you can look at them distinctively, you can actually pinpoint and actually find a solution to problems, as opposed to this big, huge, amorphous mess. Does this make sense? So within this, it's also built upon love, which is always in communication. Couples who do not communicate, and that's by going back to our first class on intimacy. Intimacy, which is about self-awareness, honesty, and vulnerability. People who do not have those three things, and they don't communicate those things, and they don't choose to do that, will not actually have love within their relationship. Because they will not have intimacy, because love is always communicated. That's why being familiar with, again, that's why I have my couples read the five love languages, things like this. But also this notion of what we call reciprocality. Which reciprocality is really important in relationship. Because many people in relationships go into buying and selling love. I'll do this for you when you do this for me. That's called contract behavior, right? You do this, I do this. I do this, you do this. I do this. When I get this, I'll finally give you this. When you treat me the way that I want, then I will finally resume relations with you, so forth and so on. That makes sense? It's a contract, right? You didn't fulfill the contract, you lose this contract relationship. That is not reciprocal. That is not the notion of reciprocality. Reciprocality is that there's no beginning or end to it. It's that both parties are giving 100%, and that does not mean that both parties are giving equally. Why? Because one of them might be intellectually smarter, more apt. So they might be producing more money and things like that. But the other one, what? It's not about total equality, because no one is actually totally equal, the same as another person. It's that both parties are giving 100%. And maybe that's where one party might be doing, like in terms of like the house chores and things like that. One party might be doing like 70% or 80% or 90%. And they're like, you're only doing 10%. But the question is both parties giving 100% of their effort? Because when you start looking at it and start breaking it down into numbers, like, well, I'm doing 50, you're supposed to do 50, and you're supposed to do, numbers don't really work really well in relationship. Because we as human beings are more than numbers, right? What we're meant to be is that we're meant to be that both parties are assured that the other person is putting forward 100% effort. If you knew that your spouse was putting forward 100% of their effort, would you have a big problem with that? No. The problem is that we suspect that they're not. That's one more often than not the main reason, is that we suspect that they're holding back, that they're being lazy, that they're not really entering 100% into the relationship. If we knew that the other person, though, maybe they're not just emotionally there. Maybe they don't have a lot of emotional intelligence. Maybe they don't have a lot of academic intelligence. But that was fine. You didn't marry them for those things. What you want is 100% of their effort. Am I speaking like Greek? I don't think so. That's what we want. We want 100% because what? In reciprocality, there is no buying and trading and selling. Reciprocality is built upon the notion that both parties are doing 100%, and therefore you don't even have to worry about, again, matching and making things equal. It's also why this is actually a principle of what we call Trinitarian theology. What? This is one of the ways in which we actually reflect the Trinity, which is what? Without beginning or end, the notion of reciprocality lies at the very heart of the Trinity. The Father gives 100% of himself to the Son. The Son receives the entirety of the Father and returns 100% of himself back to the Father. That there is an unconditional act, a complete gift of love to the other, where they hold nothing back. They're giving in themselves 100. What? And that there's not a buying and selling. There's not a contract. It's a covenant. It's also what God desires to be with us, is not a contract relationship, but a covenant relationship. Because covenant relationship is built upon the notion of reciprocality, which also takes trust. Because if you're in a relationship without trust, it's like a car without gas. You're not going anywhere. Trust and honesty, which is honesty, not just honesty on the level of the flesh, but honesty on the level of the heart, honesty on the level of the mind, what's really going on, being able to share that, being able to enter into that. That's where a lot of people, I'm honest in terms of like the finances and things like that, but what's going on interiorly, many people are not. That's where they, wear masks. And they hide behind masks and things of this nature. But they what? They hold back parts of themselves. They don't give 100%. Right? Anytime that a person is dishonest, even in little white lies, I'm not saying that does a person ask, do I look good, and they don't particularly like it. No, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about when the person asks you to say something, revealing something of your heart, and you divert. You divert, you go around it, you make excuses, or you do things like that. Those are what I'm talking about. And that's where what? That's where a person starts pulling back to what? 98%. I'm not willing to give 100% of myself. I'm only going to give 90%, or 50%, or 30%, or what? And what makes me comfortable is like 62%, right? And that's where problems go wrong. Because we're meant to give 100%, which means that we are meant to be 100% honest. Honest in all areas of life. What's worth living for? What's worth suffering for? Again, what's worth dying for is why even the ancient Greeks said it's better to fail with honor than to succeed by fraud. Because a person who succeeds by fraud, eventually it all collapses down around them and they're gone and forgotten. Versus the person of honor is always remembered. In certain ways, men and women are like cats and dogs. We are, in some ways, very similar and the same. But in other ways, we are entirely different. And those, actually, in those differences, the difference complements and fulfills the other. This is actually how God designed it from the very beginning. And the complementarity between the sexes. Where woman is lacking, man is strong. And where man is lacking, woman is strong. And this is not true, not just on the basis of relationships, which is about where you find a person who compliments you, but this is actually even on the human species. There are ways in which women are qualifiably different than men. One of the things with gender, and it's where all this gender stuff comes in especially, there was a study which was done not too long ago on gender, trying to see, is gender, I believe it was a sociology test, it was about, is gender assigned by culture? Like, are the gender roles and gender and all the things we associate with gender, is this something which is assigned by culture? And so therefore, if it's assigned by culture, it's fluid, and therefore you can make it be whatever you want it to be. But it was interesting, so they did a study on children on the ages of about 2 to 3 years old before they started becoming aware of cultural realities. Now, would they be affected in culture by some sense? Yes, but they really with the cognitive skills yet to really be fully affected by an awareness of gender roles and things like this. And so then that's why 2 to 3 year olds, they can't tell the difference. So actually what they did in this particular study is that, and they did it across the entirety of the planet. They did it in Asia, they did it in Australia, they did it in Africa, they did it in North America, South America, and Europe. And in this, they placed about 30 objects on a table in front of the kids. All these different kids, boys and girls, to see if they gravitated towards particular things associated by their sex. You know what they found? For the massively across the board, almost all the little girls gravitated towards the little doll-like figure that they could cuddle with. And all the boys gravitated towards the stick-like figure that they could turn into a weapon. Right? And this is across the entire planet. This is before there's an awareness. Now, is this definitive proof? No. But I'd say that when you're talking about gender, because it's a spiritual reality and part of it is invisible, and that's what the things of spirit are, invisible realities which exist, I can demonstrate things to you, but I can't prove it 100%. And actually, things of a spiritual nature, you can never prove 100% because that's the definition of spiritual. Lies outside physical. Therefore, it lies outside the principles of the scientific method. Even Descartes, who's the modern thinker behind Cartesian thought, if you know anything about philosophy, Descartes, who's where we get this idea that the only thing which is real is that which is examinable. Even Descartes didn't deny that there were spiritual realities. Descartes just said, I can't evaluate them. I can't judge them. I can't measure them. Therefore, I'm not concerned with them. That's what Descartes said. But he didn't deny spiritual realities. He recognized that there were certain things which lay outside the scope of the measurable. Does this make sense? Because when dealing with gender, you're dealing at times with things which are not measurable, but which are, what? Demonstrable. I can demonstrate, I can show, I just can't scientifically prove. But I can also do this, I can point to when you violate certain things, that it has effects, cause and effect, because cause and effect still applies in spiritual reality. So when you look at this, we have a notion that when you look at the genders, there's two things that you have to evaluate. Equity and equality. And these are two very important words, because equity involves trying to understand and to give everyone what they need in order to enjoy happy and healthy lives. Equality, in contrast, tries to give everyone exactly the same thing. Okay? Now, equality, there are certain ways in which, in terms of, food, hydration, shelter, things like this, we have an equal need, right, for these types of things. But in terms of love, everyone needs love, but do all of us need the same type of love? Well, for instance, one of the things I use is the five love languages, right? Well, the five love languages, which we had a series on, but is physical touch, words of affirmation, acts of service, gift giving, and drawing a blank. Quality time. Thank you. Quality time. You know what's interesting about little kids? If the little kids manifest actually a particular type of love, that's why some kids are real touchy. Like, you know how they come up and they're like cling to you? And like they always want to be held and things like that, because that their love language is touch. And some kids, like you try to pat them and they like slap your hand. It's like my nephew Anthony. But so you have certain children who what? If you spank a child whose love language is physical touch, you might do a lot more damage to them psychologically than if you were to verbally disparage them or say something to them in a strong voice. On the other hand, if you have a child whose primary love language is words of affirmation, they're always looking to please and things like this, and they're coming out and they're like waiting with expectation, and then you verbally disparage them, what? That's going to cause a lot more trauma for the one whose actual word they receive in words of affirmation, versus that if you were to spank the one whose words of affirmation, they might, it's not going to be as traumatic for them, right? So what? You treat actually children in discipline, if you treat them exactly the same, you will do damage. Some of them will flourish, and some of them will actually not. That's why and little kids will actually point this out, which is that it will say you're not being fair, right? But discipline is not fair. Discipline is not meant to be fair. Discipline is just. It's not fair. Because justice is not about fairness. And that's where some people think that they would equate the word fairness to justice. It's not the same thing. Because justice is at times not fair. Because fair is what? About perfect equality. That's what the word equality means. Fair. Right? But not everything is fair. And this is actually true in Scripture. God does not treat us fairly. Right? There's a parable which talks about where Jesus gives this parable where one person is given one talent, one person is given five talents, and another person is given 10 talents. Right? Does that mean that God loves the person who's given 10 more than the one who he loved given one? St. Paul says very clearly God does not play preferences. What he gives each in the measure in which they can receive. He loves them what all, and he overflows them all with what they can receive. He doesn't treat them exactly the same. He treats them with equity. Because equity gives people what they need in order to enjoy and have happy and healthy lives. That's why when you discipline, that's why when little kids say to their parents, you're not being fair. That's right, I'm not being fair. Because I'm giving you what you need, and I'm giving this one what they need. And actually showing them the difference between that can actually be very helpful. Because then they start recognizing, oh, I'm not exactly the same as this person over there. It actually helps them psychologically to develop and understand not everyone is not like me. That actually it goes against narcissism, where everyone has to be just like me, right? It's actually important to show them that not everyone is not just like you. And actually, if I were to spank you, it would be more traumatic than if it was for this one. Does this make sense? So what? So love, the way in which we actually encounter, that's not just true with kids, that's true with adults. That's true with all of us. Love, we're not all exactly the same. And you have to take into account the differences. That's actually an exploratory and it's actually a fun thing that we do. We like that. We like that not everyone's the same. But then when we get into the simplistic mode where we try to equate all human beings to being exactly the same, we do damage to them. Because, here's my favorite little cartoon to demonstrate the difference. It says, for a fair selection, everyone has to take the same exam. Please climb the tree. All right? You don't treat people fair. You treat them justly. Recognizing where's the times where we are called to be fair, and we're called to give everyone exactly the same because we all have certain equal needs, but also taking into account where are we different. Actually, during the Victorian age, the main language, and this was actually why the suffrage movement kind of came about, the main language in terms of gender and things like this that was being talked about all the time was equity. But they took equity to the extreme where they started separating the sexes. To the extreme, so far so, that there was, again, a suppression of one sex over the other during the Victorian age. And that's why you had the beginning of the suffrage movement, which countered. But now we've gone to the opposite extreme. Which is actually usually always the case. You go like a seesaw goes from one extreme to the other. Is that what? Not saying that there's anything wrong with the suffrage movement, but now we're talking about that actually to be equal, to be just, that we have to be treated and have exactly the same. And that there is no appreciation for differences. Because actually in differences, if there are no differences, what is lost is beauty. Beauty, the transcendental beauty, is found in the appreciation of something other than myself, which I find beautiful. Actually why many things, why we're losing actually even a conception of actually transcendental beauty. Especially beauty not just found in artwork, but beauty found in relationship. And when there's no longer an appreciation that in my differences, see little kids, when like they don't have the appreciation for beauty, what, before the age of puberty, is that what? Anyone different than me is stupid, right? But they can focus on truth, and they become little beings of pure truth, right? So everything they see is black and white. And they, what, they say the truth over and truth and truth. Everyone who's different than me is, but then all of a sudden you hit puberty and you're able to say, no, you're different from me. You're not the same as me, and yet there's something which is beautiful. What? That's where you find Eros, the beginnings of Eros, and appreciation. Eros is meant to be the most mature of all the loves. It has become the most immature, but it is meant to be the most mature because only in Eros can you have actually an appreciation of beauty, which you can't find really for the most part in the other ones. Sin, from the very beginning though, sin prevents us from accepting our masculine and feminine heart. Sin also will affect us in common, right? Sin does affect us in common, but the experience is going to differ based upon whether a person has a feminine heart or whether they have a masculine heart. Now, why can I say this? Because when you look at sin, there are three relationships which equally they fall in perfect equality. They both. Adam and Eve fall in their relationship with God. Adam and Eve fall in their relationship with one another. And Adam and Eve fall in relationship with the world. Right? This is an equal, right across the board, same. They both will experience this equally. So the beginnings of internal discord, when they're no longer in relationship with God, now they have internal discord, internal anxiety, all those internal things that go on when they no longer have wisdom and light to understand themselves. They now have the battle between the sexes and the beginning of war, which will play out in the lives of their children, Cain and Abel. Okay, but you also have what? They can no longer enter into their role as the gardeners of the planet. They now will become the tyrants of the planet, so their role actually as gardeners, as caretakers, as stewards, is lost in the whole mix. Because if they can't, they don't know themselves, then they can't appreciate each other. How the heck are they supposed to be able to take care of their role in the planet? They're not. And the planet has actually become the third victim. Does this make sense? So in terms of this, but what? If you look at the experience of the fall, they will have two different curses. What? A curse will be leveled on Adam. If they were exactly the same on a spiritual, because remember, sin is not a physical reality. And that's what Jesus says about sin. He says sin doesn't exist in the pig or in the cow or in all these things in the external. He said sin doesn't exist outside in the external physical world, which was Gnosticism. He says sin exists within your heart. Sin is from within the heart of man that all sin comes. He said that's where the source of sin is. So what? Sin is not physical, not biological. You see what I'm getting at here? If sin was physical and biological, then it should affect them exactly. But it's not. There's more to it than that. Sin is a spiritual reality. Sin affects them on a spiritual level, which is also when sin affects them, if they were exactly the same, they would actually, the curses would be exactly the same. But they're not exactly the same. Adam has his curse. Eve has her curse. Eve actually gets two. Adam gets one, but Adam's is really bad. Eve's gets two. Does anyone know what the curse of Adam is? He will toil fruitlessly at the earth and produce thistles and thorns. Okay? And the earth will recoil. When a number three, the earth will recoil from his touch. And actually, the more he puts his effort into it, the less he will produce real fruit. The curse of Eve, she will, one, the pains of childbirth will increase. That doesn't mean, women, that there was no pains of childbirth before. No, it says that they will increase. Because what? Now she's going to bring children into a world torn by war, the psychological pains, where she knows she's not taken care of, where she doesn't have a spouse, where she's been abandoned, where she's being abused, where she doesn't have the resources, where she's a single mom, where she doesn't want it herself because she's selfish and she wants to take care of her own needs. All what? The pains of childbirth will increase. Right? So we're actually not even really talking even about really even the physical. Because what? This is spiritual. The spiritual pains, which would not have been accompanied. If you're in the Garden of Eden and you have as much food and you have as much, and you're never going to die, you're never going to get old, your body's never going to break down, you have no problem having kids. It's only in the face of death, which breaks down the body, right? Where women are afraid of losing their beauty and so forth and so on, that there's a problem with children. But if you're in a state of eternal youth, there's no problem with children. If you're in a state of eternal bliss where you have resources, the main reason why people don't want to have kids is because of what? Resources, right? Money. They're black holes for money, right? But if you have no problem, if there's no problem with resources, then there's no problem with children, right? But if there's death and there's a lack of resources now, you have a huge problem. Pains of childbirth will increase. And yet what? Yet she will desire her husband's affections. She will what? She'll desire the man's affections. That's a curse. Because no longer will she find her self-worth and her self-identity found within herself. Now she will try to seek it in the eyes of the other. Think about middle school girls who sell themselves out because they're what? They're looking for the relationship. Or women. I mean, we wish it stopped in middle school, but how often does it go into adulthood? Where people still looking because they don't see their self-identity, because you can only find your self-identity truly and be comfortable with yourself as if you're rooted in God. But if you're cut off from number one, you don't know yourself, right? You don't know your value or your worth. You don't know you're the pearl of great price. And therefore what? How many girls try to earn affection? Try to earn love, try to buy love. Buy it through sex, buy it through their attractive looks, buy it through what? Through their brains, through their brawn, what? Try to be the equal of men. It's funny, the more that a woman tries to become and tries to force herself to become the equal of men, the more that she'll be rejected. It's actually true. The more that women try to enter into and try to be one of the guys, the more the guys push her away. The more that actually women are just themselves, the more that men will actually open up the group to them. That's true in the workplace, that's true in a lot of different things. Is that what? Is that this notion is that what equality, being the equal, is something which is a gift. Something which is a deserved gift, but it's still a gift. The more you try to get it, the more you will be pushed away. The more that you don't care about it to a certain extent, and you're content with yourself, you know who you are, you know you don't need it, the more it will be given to you free. Does this make sense? So in this, and just by the dint of that ancient story, just by the fact that you have different curses, shows, and because it's a spiritual reality, curses are not a physical reality, it's a spiritual reality, shows that there is a difference, a quantifiable and qualitative difference between the sexes. And so within this, what Christ actually comes to do is to restore both of them, to restore the male and the female, and to destroy the curses. Because what? When sin is removed from the picture, when Adam is redeemed and restored, which is what Christ comes to do, is that he will remove the curse of Adam so that he can actually toil at the earth but produce that which satisfies his heart. Right? Not that he's going to toil fruitlessly and produce no fruit, but he will toil at the earth and he will what? Become a fisher of men. Because it's actually relationship which is actually the greatest thing that men work towards. It's those relationships which make all of their physical work. But guys who just get so caught up in their jobs or in their activities and their hobbies or things like that, they actually never find it. It's fine, it's fun. But it gets boring after a while. But see, a relationship you can never get bored in, especially with a wife or with children and things like this, which is actually one of the things that men flee away from. I mean, think about all the fatherless families that we see in the world today. But in this, when Christ comes in, when you actually enter into, specifically in the vocation of marriage, not just in priesthood, but in the vocation of marriage, you become a father, right? And in that you find fatherhood, which actually allows you to embrace your fatherly heart with masculine joy. It actually satisfies the deepest longings of the heart to be the husband and to be the spouse. It makes all the other activities and all the other things that work for actually bear real fruit. But when these things try to bear fruit apart from that, there's no point. Quite, some guys will die isolated, lonely, and alone. This makes sense. So within that, in actually the vocation of marriage, you become, naturally speaking, a fisher of men, an apostle. When sin and selfishness is destroyed in femininity, it removes the curse of woman, which is that she finds her femininity as a blessing instead. She finds her worth in being the beloved daughter of God, which enables her to actually be the true equal of Adam, not having to seek it, but it's just given to her. Freely. She doesn't have to earn it, because she is the daughter of God. And if she's not treated like that, that's why I tell young girls, when they're not in good relationships, I'm like, you're worth more than this. If you're actually, by staying with this person, you are actually enabling them to do what they're doing to you. I said, you need to leave, for your sake and for theirs. Leave, not because you hate them, but leave for love. I said, because this is not a healthy, especially with the teenage girls, and sometimes even with adults. I say, when they're dealing with like abuse, I'm like, you do not need to stay here. God does not want you to stay and be abused because you have more value and worth. And that they have kids, they're teaching their kids that they have no value or worth. But Christ came to destroy that. Christ came to bring everyone to earth and show everyone that everyone has value, everyone has worth. Yeah. So that's why in that she finds her worth in being the beloved daughter of God, knowing her own value, as well as embracing. She doesn't have to flee or run from children. She actually desires. This is something where she finds fulfillment in. As opposed to being a curse, children become a blessing. Because actually a life without children, a life within, is actually one of the greatest things in the Old Testament, is women who didn't have children were considered cursed. The barren woman. It is. I'm just saying. It was. That's why when Jesus goes, there's two feminine figures in the Gospel of Luke or Matthew, two of them who are considered cursed. I'm not saying that every woman who doesn't have children is cursed, but I'm saying just on a bigger picture level, Jesus goes to two women who, by their society and culture, were considered barren. Jethro's daughter, who dies at the age of 12, right? And therefore, her life was considered a waste because she died fruitless. And then there's another woman in the same story who comes up to Jesus, a woman who's suffering from a hemorrhage, who's been bleeding for 12 years and has never... But in that, the connotation of the story is that she's barren. She cannot conceive life because of this constant medical problem. And therefore, she has no family. And what Jesus does for both of them is he heals them. He restores their fertility. It's actually why even Micah, David's wife in the Old Testament, she became cursed because it said she remained barren until the end of her days. This idea of barrenness is also in correlation with the understanding of the land. Land which is barren is considered to be cursed. What Christ has come to do is to restore and to renew life. It's also why life within the family is so important, so key, which is why sometimes it just happens for medical reasons, but also Christ came to what? To restore and to renew all of this, making them fishers of men just by dint of their femininity. In terms of the Old Testament, you can find actually notions of masculinity, fallen masculinity in the Old Testament. You'll find restored masculinity in the New. Because in fallen masculinity, what men are called not to be, for the most part, is the story of the Old Testament. The figure of Adam, figure of the kings of Israel, and then the figure of Peter. You'll find redeemed, restored, elevated masculinity, not just what we're called not to be, what we're called to be, the first person of the Trinity, as well within the masculine heart of Christ. Because in one of them, you'll find the one who, when confronted with evil, one of them runs away. The apostles in the garden, they run away. They cowards, they flee away from evil. Right? Versus Jesus, who confronts it head on, directly. It's actually what C.S. Lewis,
some of his literature, he'll talk about how Adam, possibly, and Scott Hahn will pick up on the same notion, Adam was actually called to confront the serpent in the Adam and Eve story, but he didn't. But you'll notice that what Adam is just seeing, they're passive and inactive. The source of activity, the source of what is, he's just not doing anything. So it's not actually, part of actually the fall starts when Adam neglects his role. Because this is what St. Paul will say. He'll say it wasn't Adam who was deceived. It was Eve who was deceived by the serpent. Anyone know that from St. Paul? St. Paul will say, Adam, but what does that mean? That means that Eve was stupid, but Adam knew it was wrong. Where's the greater sin lie? Does that make sense? Adam knew it was wrong. The command not to eat from the tree was never given to Eve. Eve knew about it, but what? It was given to Adam. Adam didn't protect. Does that make sense? Within that, the one who flees and fears evil because it possibly might lead to one's death, might lead to what? Complete loss of self. Versus Christ, who has no problem whatever with that. First person of the Trinity who initiates and gives versus the figure of Adam, as well as within the kings. When does David find himself in the most amount of trouble? When he's lazy, when he's sleeping, when he's supposed to be going to war. And that's when he gets into trouble with Bathsheba. It says, in the time when kings go to war, David was sleeping. What? The one who's languid, passive, inactive, does nothing. Just sits on the couch all day. Right? Versus the Father. The Father, the one who initiates and gives and is the source of energy and things of this nature. Is the giver, the initiator. Now, you can go to the opposite extreme, which is the kings of Israel. That's why God tells the people of Israel, you do not want a king, because he will dominate you, and he will take from you. He will take your wealth. He'll take all these different things. He will dominate and take. He said, you want me to be your king. They say, no, we want a king like all the other nations. And so you know who he gives them? Saul. And all the other kings subsequent and following will do the same thing. The domination and taking. It's also what's portrayed in Greek mythology of what all the male gods who, for the most part, dominated, take, the rapists, all the ones who would take whatever they wanted, what? Versus Christ on the cross finds a balance. He initiates and gives, and yet what? He's protecting and emptying, offering himself in his entirety on the cross. You'll also find the figure, one will generate death. If you look at just the fruits, one generates death and isolation and loneliness. Versus one will generate life, eternal life, and unity. And so within this, those ancient things where we talk about protecting and serving, well, it's more than just protecting and serving, just the way we commonly use that. There's a deep spiritual reality to masculinity in terms of both protecting and serving versus the one who will not protect, who will not serve. And but actually in this protection and service, he actually finds the fruition of his heart. He actually will produce fruit that lasts. Versus when he does not protect and serve, he will not. Femininity. Fallen, you'll actually, interesting, also refer to in the figures of Peter when he's called to be the bride, a member of the bride, but also Israel, who's always referred to as the bride, and then the figure of Eve. Then you'll find redeemed, restored, elevated femininity in the second person of the Trinity as well as in the figure of Mary. People of Israel, the bride, what? Will not be obedient, will not choose to submit and serve to the authority which protects. Now this is not, specifically it's dependent upon which protects and serves. No, femininity is not called to be subservient to abusive masculinity. Pope Francis has been talking a lot about false machoism and things like this, tries to suppress femininity and things like that. That is not, but what, is there called to be a level where there's what, a mutual service? Where also that there's a mutual submission? That's what Ephesians 5 talks about. Ephesians 5 talks about how what, both spouses are called to be obedient and to serve the other. But there's what? There's those who will not, who want to be served, but they don't want to serve. It's actually the figure of Israel throughout the emotion. They want to be served by God, but they will never serve him. And then when they're not being served, they go and follow false gods. They go like, what? Actually, that's one of the, I believe in the book of Ezekiel, he says, Israel, you're like a wandering she-camel who follows just whatever the scent is at the moment in the desert. You go off following it. Whatever your scent is, you go out. Versus Mary is obedient and chooses to be obedient to the one which protects and serves. When God asks her, she says yes. Her answer to God is always yes, because she knows that this one is protecting and serving. Does this make sense? Also in connection, you'll find the one which is arrogant and prideful, and in that arrogance and pride, she surrenders and loses her value. She actually tries in grabbing up and becoming the greater place. She loses and becomes less. Versus Mary, who's humble and grateful, content and grateful for her own, because she doesn't seek and strive to get it. You'll never see Mary trying to get a better role. Even the wedding of Cana, she slips into the background. She's always willing to take the last place. That's why Jesus says the first will be last and the last will be first. What is Mary also? She's the first person to experience the assumption, the resurrection of the body. But in this, why? Because she's not ever seeking. She knows that she doesn't need a greater place in the kingdom. She doesn't get upset. Like when Jesus says, who is my mother and my brother and my sister? Does Mary get upset? No. She doesn't need a better place. And because she doesn't need a better place, it's given to her. Does that make sense? She'll be given the best place, because that's why Mary, what? The best. That's some people who look at the Catholic Church and they're like, it's anti-Catholic, it's anti-women. I'm just like, the highest person in our church is a woman, apart from Jesus, who's God. The highest fully human, only human person is a female, which is the figure of Mary, raised up to the side of Jesus, right? This is what raised up as bridegroom does to bride. You'll find that the people of Israel, like Peter, as well as the people, oftentimes unreceptive and will not reciprocate, want to be served, but don't want to serve. One of the problems with Peter is that he doesn't want to go out and wash feet, which is why he's being what? He's a member of the bride. Even though he's a male, he still is a member of the church, member of the bride. And in that, he doesn't want to receive. He says, you won't wash my feet. He says, if I don't wash your feet, it's the same thing with Martha. She's so busy with all of her activities. She's taking care of all of it. That Then she sees Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus. He says, tell her to get up and start working. And he says, Mary's chosen the better place. He said, you need to receive if you want to give. But what, the one who is unreceptive, the one who's so busy that never receives, the unreceptive, the invulnerable one? And there's a reason why many people don't want to receive, because if you receive, you might get hurt. To be vulnerable entails you might get hurt. And so in being unreceptive and unreciprocal versus the one who's receptive and reciprocal, the second person of the Trinity receives the fullness of the Father's love and returns it in this receptive understanding. And in that, you find what? Both parties giving 100%. And in that, it's not that we're making God in our image, it's that we are made in God's image and likeness. In this, she values her unique role and encourages Adam to embrace his own. This is what we see at the wedding of Cana. It's what we see Mary at the foot of the cross. She's what? She knows that it's not her place to be on the cross. It's her place to be at what? The foot of the Master. But in being at the foot of the Master, she has to embrace helplessness. She has to embrace that she can't do it all. Actually, sometimes it's one of the greatest things, if you think about Mary being at the foot of the cross, watching a person die, sometimes it'd be better, it's even, to a certain extent, you might prefer to be dying yourself, as opposed to just be sitting and watching a person waste away. Mary knows that. But her role is to what? Be the bride at the foot, supporting the bridegroom. Does this make sense? So within that, versus one who don't need Adam, again, Jezebel, figures like that, devalues Adam's unique role and can do without Adam, doesn't need him, ultimately ends up being barren and without life, figure of Micah, and things like that. Versus the one who supports and suffers with. So where you find femininity, closed off, unreceptive, and self-sustaining, versus that which nourishes, gives, and sustains life. And this is where John Paul II will say, even in our bodies, the bodily way in which God designed us, we can see these realities reflected. But these realities are not just on an organic level. You can see them in a spiritual as well as an emotional sense, found all throughout the scriptures as well. But this is where what Christ has come to do is not to reintegrate the feminine heart with the masculine head. It's to reintegrate the masculine heart and head with the feminine heart and head, because both of them have heart and both of them have head. Both of them have an intellect and mind to contribute and things like that. I have to go because I have mass in 2 minutes. So within this, the reintegration, what Christ has come to do is to bring unity and to heal this divide which was caused. But if you discount gender and you don't understand gender and the roles and the things like this, you will actually never understand the person of Jesus Christ. Because in Jesus Christ's mission is to what? To restore Adam and to restore Eve and to reveal God's own Trinitarian heart, which shows us the template by which we were created. Not that we're creating God in his image and likeness, but that we are creating, or not that we are creating God in our image and likeness, but we were created in his image and likeness. And we'll go next week into the Trinity and why the Trinity and what we understand about the Trinity is so important. Let's go ahead and end in a prayer. In the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit, amen. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together. We ask you, Lord, to send down your Spirit upon us. Help us to fully understand where you're speaking to us in the scriptures, in our faith, and help us to employ it and to bring it into our marriages and into our lives with our family and friends. We ask all this through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou amongst women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen.